everyone. Welcome back. My name is Eugene Huff with the Legacy Marker Program, a program dedicated to the preservation and protection of monuments, memorials, and cemeteries, and in turn working with communities to bring forward their unique historical narrative. I'm very pleased today to have with us via Zoom, Ben Arco, who is my colleague and partner with the Legacy Marker Program. And I thought it'd be very important because Ken's work has been instrumental over the years through our friendship. And now we have the opportunity to share it through Mainline TV. Ken, please introduce yourself and tell some things about yourself, please.
Yeah, thanks, Gene. I'm thrilled to be here. As you said, you know, we've had a relationship for a number of years. I'm a filmmaker and broadcaster, have done so professionally since 1992. I have a interest in history and personal stories. I produce for PBS and A&E and a number of other places. I'm really interested in personal stories and interviews and the choices that people make and why they make them. I think it's really interesting. I think for the audience, it might be really great if, Gene, if you want to share the story about how we first met in Augusta, Georgia at St. Paul's Church, because I think it was really fascinating.
Absolutely. I was invited to go down in 2003 to conduct a long-term conservation project on a colonial cemetery at St. Paul's Church in Augusta, Georgia. And for me, growing up along the main line, I was very interested in Valley Forge and Philadelphia campaigns for Revolutionary War history. But in going down south, I learned something that I didn't get any in my school books. Eight Indian tribes, huge involvement with the Southern campaigns about history. And really a throwback in time. And so in working on this cemetery, one of the days I was there, I was working on a Colonel Fennessy's monument who served in the American Revolution. He was an orphan from Italy and ended up settling in Augusta, Georgia. Who would have thought? But you came through with your father-in-law, I believe, and he was a World War II veteran. And we were talking a little bit, and I think it was either you or your father-in-law said, "Hey, Gene, who else can do this type of work?" And I said, "Ken, I have a background working with special needs kids, but I also working with students in general. There's a huge component here where this type of work could be a benefit for veterans with TBI, PTSD." And quite frankly, after that meeting, over many periods leading up to, I guess it was about 4 or 5 years ago, the opportunity for your offer to do a film came to fruition.
Yeah, I remember the scene in the church because we were doing a graveyard walk and you had a little tent up and you had a lantern and you were busy at night kind of chiseling away on this monument, and I was just fascinated by it and always have had a fascination with American history. As you said, I was visiting my father-in-law and he was a World War II vet and a Korea vet. And what happened was a number of years later, I had the opportunity. I was working as a freelance producer in Chicago, and I had an opportunity to do a couple stories for the Al Jazeera America Network. They had a show that was on. It was their version of 60 Minutes called America Tonight. And they wanted interesting stories about America. And I remembered you in that graveyard and talking about how you could work with disabled vets and students and teachers to kind of share history. And I pitched the story, and they loved it. And they made it possible for me to come out to the Paoli battlefield with you and spend, I don't remember if it was 2 or 3 days. And we filmed the restoration project of the monument with a bunch of really great veterans who were there to assist you and learn about monument and plaque restoration. And the film restoration that we did, it's a 9-minute piece that was done, as I said, for Al Jazeera. And it was really well received and it touched a lot of people. And it really profoundly touched me because I didn't expect how much being out in the field with you, working on that monument, how profoundly that would affect the veterans. You could see a change in them. They felt a lifeline to other veterans that had gone through kind of their experiences. And it was a profound piece that had a great effect on me. And it was the basis for, you know, for our friendship and the continued talk that we have. And I think it was kind of if you want to really say it, it's the foundation for the Legacy Marker Program.
You know,
And the thing is, you know, people can see restoration if they go to our website, legacymarkerprogram.org. They can kind of watch it there.
It's powerful in the fact that I had shared with one of the gentlemen, he was a interpreter for our army in Iraq, and he, Muslim faith, and he basically, in the film, he tells how his home was bombed, an explosion went off because they learned that he was helping our troops. But besides this testament, and you need to go see the film Restoration on our website, which talks a little bit more of certainly what we're trying to do. It's new. Ken and I need to work on some other things that can improve that, because we're not website designers and we could certainly use some feedback from individuals. But the story is very compelling, because I shared with Muhammad that he said, you know, this type of thing would help with veterans overseas from different countries that don't have the resources we have in our country. And it also is a subtle sign of diplomacy that hallowed ground is something important. It can be a healing and nurturing site. And we see not only stateside, but the benefit of what we're trying to do. And certainly, Ken, your role as a writer and producer of the film, the stories are what are incredibly important. We can do projects, I can do projects, but what it's done, if we haven't documented it, it's just like mainline TV. It's a crucial role today in telling the stories and sharing stories with as many producers. It's crucial. It's not old world. It's very up-to-date information that I think people appreciate. So we're very fortunate for this.
Well, and yeah, I mean, that's the thing that I think, you know, I'm able to bring to your mission, and that is the video component of Legacy Marker Program. It's that documentation, you know, the sharing of knowledge with a wide audience. And the thing is it can be shared over time. That's the really kind of important thing. It's not something that happens in the moment and then it's never heard from again. We can share this out and out. And one of the things I was going to bring up is the fact that video is the most, you know, powerful emotional connecting communication medium that we have today. You know, I think I was telling you the other day, the statistic I saw from Cisco, the router manufacturer, that estimates that by 2022, video is going to make up 82% of all the traffic on the internet. You know, it's just an amazingly powerful medium. You know, and the thing is one of the things that we're trying to get across with Legacy Marker, that we want people who are in these communities or people who have these monuments that need restoration, one of the things we want them to understand is there's this big fear of video being expensive, you know, that you have to have millions of dollars to do this kind of stuff. And it's not necessarily true. Video is expensive, yes, granted. But there's two really important kind of things that I would really like to stress, if I can have a minute to do that. And one is that a piece of video, like an interview or a B-roll that we shoot and cut, can be reused multiple times. You have to kind of think of it in those terms. You can cut it down. You can take an interview with someone, cut it down into short social media messages. The return on investment of video can be high. You know, if you're thoughtful and careful and when you're planning and shooting and know that you're going to use this a bunch of different ways. And the other thing, too, is a lot of folks fall into the trap of, well, we can do the video cheaply. You know, we can give my 8-year-old nephew an iPhone and it won't cost anything. But the fact of the matter is it does cost. One of the things that people never realize is that video lives forever on the web. This is something you have to really think about. When you put something on YouTube, YouTube owns it. YouTube can share it forever. And so that is out there. That's your reputation that's out there for the world to see. And so you have to ask yourself, what's your reputation worth? You know, you really want to tell these stories in a professional, thoughtful way. And the thing is that the reputation part of this thing is really important, because, you know, there's an old saying about reputation, takes 20 years to build and 20 seconds to destroy, you know. So my point being is that video doesn't have to cost millions of dollars to make. You know, you can be creative and thoughtful, and you can do it in a way that shares this important message like we're trying to do with Legacy Marker Program. But the other thing it can do is the videos that we create for Legacy Marker Program can be used in schools to educate people. They can be used to promote local travel and tourism. You know, people get excited about possibly coming to Valley Forge or coming to Yorktown. Well, now they have these videos that they can watch and they can learn about it before they even come there. So that's what's really, really important, I think, about adding the video component to the Legacy Marker program. And that's kind of what I want to bring to this.
I think closer to home, also, we note that with the 250th anniversary coming up, there are going to be lots of events taking place in this country, and that's great. But Ken and I discussed how and my involvement with some military fraternal organizations and historical societies, and Ken knows this from being on the road, the stories are out there that sometimes are absolutely amazing, that they're not the ones that are going to be on the front page and featured for some of these celebratory occasions. And so with the events leading up to the 250th, Ken and I have just been discussing about almost like a Charles Carroll component, who we love that gentleman, to go on the road to various communities, including the Radnor Mainline community, to take on documenting some significant sites, working with students, but most importantly, testimonials from the students themselves. We know that there are a few photographs of the Radnor War Memorial, and hopefully that can be put up on the screen, which I've been working each year volunteering as a member of not only of Aikman Balaguer, Post 668 in Wayne, but also through the Legacy Marker Program, to work with local students in the community, including Radnor High School, Radnor Middle School, St. Catherine School, students to each year do conservation on that monument biannually. And what is impressed upon the students is they get up and personal, working in teams, discussing each other about the importance and symbolism of that one monument. And ironically, with the pandemic right now, these gentlemen who were born in the latter part of the 1890s, in the early 1900s, they either signed up and were involved in the war or possibly succumbed to even the pandemic like a lot of people. They survived, many of them, as many of the people did, and they carried on with their families and carried on with life. And so there's a story there, but it's almost eerie that it's close to 100 years anniversary of that great war. But if you bring back the layered history of what an onion has, there are many layers to history. We need to tell the stories. And so for the 250th, we bring forward to that event unfolding. Ken and I feel there's an opportunity all the way from Yorktown up the East Coast to visit communities, to share their stories, but most importantly, with the students. And with them involved, they're going to be the ones that can share that message with kids in California or even students overseas. And we've secured the domain name, ushistoryportal.com, I believe. Is it going to be com or org, Ken? Do you recall?
I believe it's going to be org, Gene.
Okay. With that, it will allow, hopefully, and I've already spoken with some of the mainline librarian groups who say, hey, look, through the interlibrary network, we can work with you to share that information, local stories, but allow students who are interested in the Radnor and mainline area relating to the Revolutionary War, there's lots of information that can come forward. And that's what makes it exciting. And Ken Wells know it's all about partnerships.
Well, yeah. And the thing I was going to, also add to this is, the sense that especially, where you're located, history is all around us. I mean, you literally are walking, the same streets that these history, the American history happened. And we have this responsibility to develop this next generation to carry on, to continue to tell these stories and to continue to be able to document it. And one of the things that I want to bring to the organization is the ability to bring in students that are interested in filmmaking and are interested in videography, to bring them to these sites and teach them how to do documentation, how to tell and retell these stories. So not only are we preserving the stories, but we're also building the next generation of people that will carry that on, because life is short and we'll be gone before you know it. And in dealing with history, these moments are a drop in time. So just a drop of water in time. So it's super important to not only share the information. One of the other things we're talking about is doing oral histories. So many people are leaving us on a daily basis, and so many people have this history that if we don't record it, if we don't share it, it's gone forever. So I would love nothing better than to build, for lack of a better term, since we're talking historical, we're talking Revolutionary War, I'd like to build this army of young videographers who are out there who have a passion for history that carry the torch forward and find amazing stories in their areas that they document. And as you said, share, you know, student in Pennsylvania sharing with students in a classroom in California who are sharing some of this information. There would be nothing that I'd be happier to come out of this with than just the next generation of people that can tell these stories.
I think with Mainline TV and speaking with the director there, I'd mentioned that Valley Forge Military Academy and their is Military Academy College is right here in the Radnor Wayne area. And I've spoken to students there and teachers because they had come out and participated in a project at the Devon Amy Church, African American Church in Devon, and it was very well received. And we were discussing how we could do possibly a project on some of the monuments at Valley Forge. And in speaking to the director at Mainline TV, he says a lot of these studios, it's very expensive to have technicians and full staff and whatnot, but their mission is such, they would like nothing better than to possibly come out and show those students filming, like Bennett, you are proposing, Studio Mainline TV showing how that is done. So it's part of their mission that it's not just running out there. There's a technique to it, but the more we can show that, it's going to get more people breaking away from just using their cell phones for documenting, because it really is art. And you look at like a Charles Kuralt or Andrew Wyeth, from a painting standpoint, these gentlemen were not only artisans, but they knew history, and they were very good at sharing and interpreting and from that. So we're sort of in a position of following their lead, not developing a new mousetrap per se, but slowing down, but using the wonderful technology. But it's about the stories and mentoring in teams, working on projects. And again, it goes back to our mission. Each community has a historical narrative to share. And the beauty of that is if you make the right contacts and find the right gatekeepers in the communities who are interested in it, in the story, like James Mishmer, who had students go out and had 10 graduate students that went down for the book, Chesapeake. And they went out and asked questions and got feedback. And with that, it was a planting of a seed that blossomed into a wonderful narrative that the reader was able to understand the history of the region. Our project, and with Ken's key role, is to bring that narrative forward in a way that not only complements the communities who actually have a chance to record and share important information, but as I said, we have said, share it on a broader scale. One student said, who we met at the marker in Wayne during the restoration project this year, said that he said overseas through these history networks, there's all sorts of youth interested in American history. And I said to him, well, having you speak to your peers might have more of a registration than either Ken and I all the time, because you are of that generation. And he agreed. So we're going to need to have those young men and women be a part of our process of sharing this narrative.
Yeah, and the other kind of arm of this is, you know, public supported television, like, you know, we're on today, is one of the key components in sharing this narrative, you know, not only locally but regionally and nationally. So there's a strong component. I have a deep passion for public television. My grandmother, who came from Poland, learned how to speak English by watching documentaries on public television. And that to me is an anchor that is always going to be kind of, you know, the third arm of this project that we're doing. You know, I'm really interested in getting this information out to the widest group of people who can see it, regardless of whether, you know, it's, you know, pay TV or public television. I just want people to see this, and through our partnership with public television, I think this is the way to go. So, absolutely. Hey, I was going to ask you, did you want to, you were telling me something really interesting about Valley Forge the other day, about how people are kind of unprepared when they go there.
Yeah, basically what I have found, having done, I apologize for that, I've found that in speaking to docents at not only the Yorktown Museum, Jamestown Museum, the Philadelphia Visitors Museum Center for the Revolutionary War Center, and the Valley Forge Tourism Group, is that people love American history. But what's happening is they say, hey, we're going to go to Valley Forge this year, and they plan to go, and they get there, and the docents basically say people have not done their research. And not in a negative manner, but saying that these folks, once they're here, are wowed by the area. And but there's no time in a short period to get all the information you need from brochures. Even if you go along our Pennsylvania Turnpike Welcome Centers, they're chock full of maps and brochures and things, and that's all good and fine. But we feel, in speaking with Ken, and the docents agree, there's got to be a better way that we can share that historical narrative. And possibly the history portal will be that. But and I share the one example of Fort Ticonderoga. They basically have teachers oftentimes from different parts of the country, even overseas, inquiring to express interest in learning something about the area. But if they go to the website, Google or Wikipedia, they're inundated with other sorts of cookies. They go away from the narrative. So Ken and I are hoping that we can work with communities to do these spotlights, working with libraries and local historical groups to do this. And so, and this will not be our first presentation. We're looking forward to doing more spotlights on mainline TV as we move forward. And it's been very exciting, obviously, to introduce Ken. And we do have a short film, and it is Memorial Day weekend. You had mentioned, hey, Gene, put a flag up behind you on the shoulder, and I did that. It's called The Patriot. It's a bird on top. Maybe we could run that flag folding ceremony, which was held out at Edgemont Memorial a year ago, and it's a very powerful video that embodies history and the importance of community.
Yeah, so I was going to say, Gene, you know, it's really interesting. I mean, the flag ceremony, the amount of people that actually came out and participated in that, and the responses that you got from people were actually really, really quite profound and quite amazing. I think when you do these events, I think the thing that you walk away from is that people are passionate about history. If we can find a way to involve them, find a way to bring them into the field and out of the books, so to speak, I think that you really do kind of, you do really kind of hit a nerve with people.
The idea of the flag obviously is the handshake, the white gloves, the introductions at the beginning. Down at Yorktown, the sponsor had the people break up because they basically kept talking because they had never met each other before. So that's something that's very special. And considering the number of states now, 11 states are over 5,400 plus, I believe now, groupings of people. We're hoping to even get this flag down to Washington, D.C. and down to other communities to receive the flag, but also promote how our program can help stimulate and sharing the wonderful stories of their communities.
Well, and I was going to say, I mean, it just goes to reemphasize something that we said, you know, in the beginning, that history is all around us. You know, and the fact is our lives are so busy and so full that you don't stop to see it. But once you do stop to see it and you bring people into it, you can see that they're you know, incredibly interested in it, and they have an incredible passion for it. They love to come out to these events. You know, and you know, we have a tendency to take for granted because we walk right through it every day. But I think the idea behind this, to bring people out, to get people involved, to get people to remember the sacrifices that were made. You know, I think it's really all American. It's exactly who we are, and it's exactly kind of what people are missing right now. You know,
it dovetails, and I think, you know, in closing, I want to wish everyone a respectful Memorial Day weekend. It's not about sales. It's really about people who served, and many of them ultimately paying the ultimate sacrifice. And with the pandemic, we're wanting people to be optimistic and rejuvenate towards the years ahead, because Legacy Marker Program is all about promoting an American success story. We want to thank Ken very much for introducing himself. Again, you can go to our website, legacymarkerprogram.org, contact us. We'll be sharing more information moving forward. And most importantly, we want to thank Mainline TV for all their help.
Yeah, it's been a great opportunity to come and speak with you. Thanks again to Mainline TV, and we ask people to support them because they bring this kind of information and they bring this kind of community together. So it's really been important, and we're really excited about the opportunities that we're going to have moving forward with Legacy Marker Program. So thanks, Gene. I appreciate it.
Until next time, everyone, Legacy Marker Program. Thank you.